So now we will have a presentation from Anna Pitaluga. So Anna is a pharmacist and she got a PhD in pharmacology and toxicology. She is now an associate professor at the University of Genoa. And well, she is an expert in the study of the release of neurotransmitters for isolated nervous terminus, so-called synaptosomes.
Yes.
So please.
Thank you very much for your kind introduction. First of all, I would like to thank the organizing committee for kind invitation. I would like to thank Brunella Parodi for this possibility to come here and present you some results we have recently obtained in our lab that concern the effect of the HIV-1 viral protein TAT on central neuron transmission. And in particular, I will focus on results obtained in human brain. Why we focus on TAT? TAT is a viral protein, is produced and actively released by infected cells, and is thought to represent one of the major compounds that involved in the onset of neurological symptoms that often accompany HIV-1 infection. And here you can see some of these symptoms. And all these symptoms are called HIV-1 associated dementia. And this pathology represents one of the major complications of HIV-1 infection. And this pathology is resistant to antiretroviral therapy. And it is supposed to represent one of the major aspects of HIV-1 infection in the future because of the function of antiretroviral therapy and because patients are expected to become lung survivor. Why there are these complications, central neuronal complications? Because during infection, there are alterations in the blood-brain barrier, and this can allow the virus to enter in central nervous system. And in central nervous system, the virus can infect resident macrophages and microglial cells. This aspect implies two major consequences. When a patient are exposed to antiretroviral therapy, the virus infection can be controlled in all the organs, but not in central nervous systems, because almost all the antiretroviral drug cannot permeate the blood-brain barrier. And therefore, CNS can represent sites from where HIV-1 can start to reinfect the human being. And the other point, the other consequences, is that the infected cells can actively release viral component that can act a chemical synapses and can induce some impairments in central neurotransmission. Which is the role of TAT in HIV-1 infection? TAT is very important because it is the transactivator of transcription. In other words, in the absence of TAT, you cannot have a complete HIV-1 infection. TAT is a very little molecule. It's composed by about 100 amino acids. And it is encoded by two exons. The first exon is encoded for the first part of the protein that corresponds to the first 72 amino acids. And this part of the protein possesses the full transactivator activity. And this sequence can be further subdivided in the five domain. And the most important domain is the one that corresponds to amino acid 48-59. And it is called a rich basic domain. And it is particularly rich in arginine. The second exons encode for the remaining part of the protein. And that is 7300, 100, 110. It depends on the strain. And this part of the molecule is important for adhesion. In particular, it contains the RGD motif, and this motif is the one that can bind integrin receptors. Beside the effect, the important role in HIV-1 infection, TAT can also induce changes in central nervous system. In literature, there are a lot of data concerning the impact of TAT on microglial cells and on astrocytes. But today, I would like to focus exclusively on the effect on neurons. The first data concerning the effect of TAT on neurons are from the group of Sabatier in 1991. This group demonstrated that the protein can bind in a saturable manner to the membrane of neuron, and that the peptide fragment that was responsible for this binding was the sequence that contained the rich arginine domain. Soon after, there was appear a lot of other works showing that it can be exocytotoxic, can be neurotoxic. All these effects, again, were related to the same fragment. And finally, in 1999, the group of Geiger demonstrated that TAT can activate G-protein-linked signaling and causing mobilization of calcium ions from endoplasmic reticulum because of an increased production of EP3. Again, the sequences involved was the sequence 4862. Because of the positive effect that exerts on calcium mobilization, we speculated that can also modify neurotransmitter release because you know that you can induce, you can evoke the release of neurotransmitter in an exocytotic-like manner if you increase the bioavailability of calcium ions within the cytosols. So, since we have a long story on the study of neurotransmission, we decided to investigate the impact of TAT on the release of neurotransmitter. And first, we focus on human brain. And all the data that we'll present you are data that have been obtained on human synaptosome, isolated nerve terminals. Why we focus on human brain? Because as probably you know, human can be infected by HIV-1 because they possess CD4 receptors, while rodent cannot because they do not possess active CD4 receptors. Therefore, it was very important to demonstrate that any modification to neurotransmitter could be observed in human terminals. We have the chances to work on human samples that we obtained because of collaboration with the Galliera Hospital. The Galliera Hospital is one of the two major hospitals in Genoa. And we have a long-lasting collaboration with the neurosurgery of this hospital. Samples were obtained from patients that were informed, and they're, of course, consenting, and these patients were undergoing neurosurgery because of the presence of depleted tumors. And every time we obtain something like 20 milligrams of wet tissue, and this was sufficient to carry out experiment to investigate the effect of TAT. Almost all the samples originate from parietal and temporal cortex. Of course, the patients were treated with premedication and anesthesia, and you can find here the drugs cocktails used. For who is not familiar with our techniques, I just would like to spend some few words on these techniques. Synaptosomes are pinched off nerve terminals. That is that during homogenization, you can imagine that the synaptic button is pinched off and then resealed immediately. These particles maintain all the characteristics of the nerve terminals, and that is that it can synthesize, it can uptake, it can release, it can store neurotransmitter. synaptosome are purified on Percol, and then are stratified at the bottom of superfusion chambers, and then are up-down superfused with the physiological medium. And this is the most important aspect of our technique, because the continuous superfusion assures that any compound, endogenous compound that is released, is immediately removed. Under this condition, we do not have biophases. It is impossible that any compound endogenously released can act as a feedback modulator of terminal function. In other words, you can only observe a signaling when you add exogenously compounds to the superfusion medium. As a first approach, we investigate whether TAT can modify the spontaneous release of different neurotransmitters. We investigate the impact on aspartate, glutamate, GABA, serine, noradrenaline, and acetylcholine. And I think that this compound, this transmitter, represents the major neurotransmitter in human in mammalian brain. What we observed is that TAT was unable to modify the spontaneous release of neurotransmitter of almost all the neurotransmitter, with the exception of acetylcholine. What we found was that TAT was able to cause a significant and persistent increase of acetylcholine release respect to control condition. And what was of interest is that that increased the release of acetylcholine in a concentration-dependent manner, and the effect, the maximal effect, was observed when TAT was added at 1 nanomolar, and this concentration is compatible with the concentration of TAT that you can find in the CSF of the patients, because TAT is also actively released by infected cells, and therefore it can be present in the synaptic cleft and can activate, they can modify the function of nerve terminals. We investigated the fragment of the protein that could be involved in the effect. Of interest, we found that it was involved in the sequences that was also that had the transactivator activity. We found that the sequences 3272 was active, while the one that was in the second part, contained the second part of the protein, was inactive. And in particular, we found that the more efficacy was due to the fragment 4160. We investigate the possible receptors involved positive effect exerted by TAT on acetylcholine release. We have tried a lot of antagonists. We are looking to the possible involvement of NMDA, AMPA, chemokine receptors, but finally we found that the effect of TAT was prevented by the selective antagonist at mGlu1 and 5 receptors. And I just want to remind you that these receptors are metabotropic receptors that are positively linked to phosphoinositide hydrolysis and calcium mobilization from endoplasmic reticulum. So later, other group, the group of Eugenin and Briello, hypothesized that TAT can also activate glutamate. Since we were not able to observe any effect on the spontaneous release of glutamate, we try to investigate whether or not TAT can modify the release of glutamate evoked by a depolarizing stimulus. Therefore, we exposed synaptosomes to a mild depolarizing stimulus and causes the release of a neurotransmitter. This is a mild depolarization effect because you do not observe a very important release of glutamate. But this release can be increased in a concentration-dependent manner by TAT, and again, the concentration of TAT that were able to facilitate glutamate release were in the nanomolar range. Again, we found that the effect, the facilitatory effect that TAT exert on glutamate exocytosis was due to activation of metabotropic glutamate receptors belonging to the first group. In particular, we found that the receptor involved was the mGlu1 receptors in this case. And again, we found that the receptors, the fragment of the protein that was responsive for this effect was the fragment 3772, the fragment that contained the transactivator activity. We also investigated the effect on GABA, and unexpectedly we found that differently to from glutamate, TAT was able to inhibit GABA exocytosis. Again, the effect was observed in the nanomolar range, but we were not able to characterize by a pharmacological point of view the receptors involved. Here I report the lack of effect of the mGlu1 and mGlu5 receptor antagonists that were found to be active in the previous cases, but I can also say that we were unable to revert this inhibitory effect by using NMDA receptor antagonist, chemokine receptor antagonist, and other several other ligands. And in any case, again, the fragment that was active was the fragment 3772. Just to conclude this first part, we can say that TAT can modulate, can alter the release of neurotransmitter, that it can exert opposite effect in a way that it can potentiate, but it can also inhibit neurotransmitter release. The receptors involved seems to be different. Most of the effect we have described depend on activation of mGlu1 and mGlu5 receptors, but some other effects are so far related to a receptor so far unknown. So we can add mGlu1 and mGlu5 receptors to the list of the receptors that are being proposed to represent promiscuous binding site for this protein. Because of the interaction of with metabotropic glutamate receptors, we have also considered another possibility. It is well known in literature and a great body of evidence exists that mGlu receptors, the one positively coupled to G protein and 2PLC induced hydrolysis of phosphoinositide can couple to NMDA receptors. Usually NMDA receptors allow activation of mGlu1 receptors, and mGlu1 receptors reverberate positively on NMDA receptors since they favors the phosphorylation of tyrosine residues in the carboxy tail of NR2 subunit. Since TAT was found to be a selective agonist of mGlu1 receptors, we tried to investigate whether TAT can influence the function and the releasing function of elicited by NMDA receptor. We have in the last year we have described the existence of several NMDA receptor subtype located presynaptically on different nerve terminal subpopulation whose activation is able to elicit the release of neurotransmitters. In particular, we have described the existence of presynaptic NMDA heteroreceptors that are located on noradrenergic terminals. We have described the existence of these receptors in human and in mouse terminals. And here, you can see that activation of these receptors with NMDA and the co-agonist glycine can elicit a relevant release of noradrenaline from human synaptosomes, and that this release can further increase by the presence of that protein. As you see, the release that you can observe with a 1 millimolar NMDA, 3 micromolar glycine is almost doubled by the presence of that. Again, we investigate the pharmacological profile, and we found that the protein that was involved, the fragment of the protein involved, was 3772. Since our results seem to suggest that TAT can act as a selective ligand at mGlu1-5 receptor, metabotropic glutamate receptor subtype, we have investigated whether in human neocortical synaptosomes this viral protein can trigger the enzymatic cascade event that leads to EP3 production and calcium mobilization. Then we investigate which was the impact of that on phosphoinositide hydrolysis and mobilization of calcium ions. And we found that can increase the production of endogenous EP3 in human neocortical nerve endings, and that this increase is paralleled by an increased mobilization of intraterminal calcium ion. Both effects were blocked by the antagonist at mGlu1 receptors. So just to conclude, we can conclude that beside its effect and its action on the HIV-1 infection, that can also induce changes to central neuron transmission. In particular, our results demonstrate that can modulate neurotransmitter release, and that most of the effect that we have observed depends on the binding of the rich basic domain to membrane receptors that are located presynaptically on synaptosomal membrane. This effect, the effect that we have described, do not necessarily account for neurotoxic effect. For the sake of clarity, neurotoxicity can be induced by TAT when TAT is added at either concentration. About 10 nanomolar of TAT are needed to cause neuronal death. However, this event, the effect we have described, can be involved in the impairment in central neurotransmission and well account for the neurological symptoms that typify HIV-1 associated dementia. Since mGlu1 seems a preferential binding site for the viral protein antagonist, that mGlu1 binding site may represent useful tools for the cure of AIDS-associated dementia. I just want to speculate and to continue for one more slide, one or two slides, because why I decide to present you the results concerning TAT? Because beside the effect on viral invasion, virus invasion, beside the effect on neurotransmission, I would like to stress that TAT, starting from 1994, TAT used to deliver cargos into cells. Fragment of this peptide are used and coupled to different kind of molecules, small molecules as well as great molecules, just to assure the entry of the molecules into the cells, and which is the sequences that is involved in this mechanism. Well, the peptide used contain usually the sequences 48-59. And usually the peptides that are used to deliver drugs into cells are composed of at least 16 amino acids. In most of the studies that have used TAT coupling to assure the entry of drugs into the cells, it was not verified whether or not that can induce some changes to the functional parameters. But it is known that the compounds that are used to vehiculate drugs into cells can be neurotoxic in HeLa cells and can be neurotoxic when injected into ECV in mice. Therefore, a note of caution and attention should be paid to the use of this peptide to vehiculate drug within cells. And I would just to remind the name of the person that have collaborated with me to perform all the experiment. Maurizio Raiteri is the chief of our lab, and he has supervised all the work. And we thank the neurosurgery. And this work was granted by this project. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Pitaluga, for your overview on that rule. And now the lecture is open for discussion. Okay.
Thank you for this very nice lecture. So you mentioned the amount of TAT that is found in an infected brain is compatible with the amounts that you are working with. What do we know about the cells that are producing TAT? So it's essentially what, microglia? Infected microglia?
Yeah, microglia, essentially, yeah.
And do you know of any processing of the full-length TAT into some of the specific peptides that you're studying, or you think the effects are due to the entire protein?
Yeah. I think that the entire peptide can remain for a long time in the synaptic cleft, because I'm not sure that there are enzymatic pathways that are able to cleave the protein. I think it's quite different from another viral peptide that is GP120, that is immediately cleave and you can observe only vitreal loop. Isn't it this the question?
Well, my question is whether you can get those same effects on the receptors with the full-length protein, or you really need to cut it up into some specific peptides.
Yeah, I've shown.
Okay.
We have obtained the same results when we use also Ventamis, that is TAT, for example, TAT 40 to 60, yeah.
But 40 to 60 is already a peptide. It's not the full-length protein, right?
Yeah, the full-length protein. Yeah, all the data, the first data concern the full-length protein. I mean, in all the panel, this is the full-length protein. And then we have the fragment.
Okay.
Okay, in all the panel, this is the full-length protein. And this is the Again, this is full-length protein, and these are the segment, okay?
So you have no evidence of peptide cleavage in the brain?
No, I do not. Also because I cannot use a brain specimen that come from ADS-infected patients, of course.
Other question? One over there.
I'm referring to the use of TAT peptide
for delivering
as a delivery system attached to something, particles and antibodies and so on. Do you think there is any specificity of the interaction of TAT with any kind of cell or any part of a given cell? I mean, since the liver of these...
TAT was shown to be a actively uptake from cells, but to observe an uptake of the protein, you have to add a very high concentration of the peptide. You have to work with 10 micromolar.
No, but my question was if, since the first barrier that they find is endothelia, you have any information if there is any specificity of TAT peptide for any kind of endothelia?
No, I do not have this kind of information, sorry.
Yes, thank you for the presentation. As I understand it from your slides, it's the inositol triphosphate that is involved in this mechanism of things going bad. Is there any neuroprotective drug available today that can interfere at that step to prevent these changes?
No.
Have you thought of lithium?
Sorry?
Lithium.
No. Lithium, yeah. But there is a paper that showed that the treatment with lithium salts can ameliorate the symptoms in HIV-1 positive patients that have AIDS dementia. Okay. But I didn't test it. But it's of interest, of course.
Other question? Paola.
So actually, TAT and TAT-like peptides are used, as you mentioned, in drug delivery. I think that here in the audience, many of us are using them and to deliver it for cell targeting or just as penetration enhancer. So,
yeah, I know.
Did you and you pointed out the potential toxicity of these products? Yes, and that's very important because probably we don't know it. We develop these systems, but we undervaluate probably this potential toxicity. But did you carry out any comparative experiments with other cell-penetrating peptides, such as penetrating or any other, if there is a general toxicity or just related to the TAT conformation or TAT sequences?
Well,
because it's a very huge family of peptides.
I did not carry out experiments that were aimed to investigate the impact of other peptides that are used to deliver drugs. I didn't perform, because I start from another point of view, of course.
Yeah, sure.
But I have been studying the effect of other peptide and the profile, the pharmacological profile of the effect of TAT are quite different.
Uh-huh.
So I found that it was quite specific, the effect of TAT through activation of mGluR1. But I just want to add one thing. Usually people look at neurotoxic events. But all the things I have described, I'm not so sure that they relate to neurotoxic events. I think that on the contrary, they participate to impairment of central neurotransmission. That is a different aspect.
Mm-hmm.
So not necessarily the condition that I have described can induce toxicity in cells. So it's not evident that when you had the TAT fragment, you observe toxicity. But you cannot exclude that this peptide, this fragment, can alter the releasing function, the metabolizing mechanism, and the second messenger's function within the cells. You cannot exclude.
I just would like just to add a point concerning the question of Paolo. Paolo and a lot of group just sitting over there, we work on drug delivery systems, and just to, of course, we know we use that as a penetrating agent, but I suppose, I would like just to have your comment, that one position concerns the TAT or TAT fragment, another position could be just the bioconjugation or the conjugation of that with some part of a particle, of a polymer or a vesicle, because in that case, we can change just the rule of that. And so, your opinion on this point, and if it's possible in any case to bypass the TAT, let me say, damage by carrying out a really strong linkage that is not cleaved in vitro or in vivo?
Yes. This is one possibility. Another possibility is to use a shorter peptide of TAT. I think that less than 10 amino acids
could be safe.
But on the other side, I cannot exclude that if you couple this peptide to another peptide, you can restore.
Okay.
You have to consider also the other aspect.
And another... Sorry, just to take the opportunity just to... Another question, just concerning this kind of dispute concerning pharmacologists mm-hmm. and clinician. I just, yeah. before, I'm not an expert, but just to have a really the very end point of this situation, mm-hmm. How much is relevant the neuroids, and so the rule of the action of that at the level of a central nervous system, just in the frame of the total pathology of HIV?
I think that neuroids is a pathology that is very important in our in our countries. I mean, in USA, in the countries that have more, not in Africa, not in Asia, of course, because the problem are different. But in a society where HIV-1 infected people are expected to become a long survivor because they have access to heart, they have everything they need just to go on with life, and neuroids may represent an important complication. This is what is considered in USA, for instance.
Okay, thank you. Other question?
Sorry.
Okay, if not the case, I would like just to thank you to speak again.
Thank you.
Thank you, Anna.
Thank you.